Hey, I'm deeply pained. When we talk on the governor's, speak on the governor, on the president's address, the Honorable Prime Minister leaves the chamber. Today, when we're speaking on the finance bill, the Honorable Finance Minister leaves the chamber. In any moment of decision, the best thing you can do is the right thing. The next best thing you can do is the wrong thing. And the worst thing you can do is nothing. The Honorable Finance Minister has made a mockery of the people of India in this union budget by doing absolutely nothing. Honorable Chairperson, sir, my respected colleagues, I stand here today on behalf of my party, the All India Trinamool Congress, to speak on the finance bill. Madam, I have to say I'm deeply pained at the very onset. I must point something out. When we talk on the governor's, speak on the governor, on the president's address, the Honorable Prime Minister leaves the chamber. Today, when we're speaking on the finance bill, the Honorable Finance Minister leaves the chamber. We members of the opposition are deeply pained by this. We hope that the government will take notice of our pain and be present in the House each time that we speak on relevant issues. Theodore Roosevelt, the 26th President of the United States, had said, in any moment of decision, the best thing you can do is the right thing. The next best thing you can do is the wrong thing. And the worst thing you can do is nothing. The Honorable Finance Minister has made a mockery of the people of India in this union budget by doing absolutely nothing. Whatever little changes are there are regressive and ill thought out. Means that the people did not want a business as usual approach. The people wanted a course correction. What have you done? You've not listened to the mandate. Vinash Kale Viprit Buddhi, you have done the exact opposite. You've kept the same cabinet, you've kept the same finance minister who's given the same shoddy budget. Who is this budget for? The middle class make up 31% of India. The poor make up between 60 and 65% of India. I will demonstrate how this budget systematically strangles the poor and the middle class. This is a kursi bajao budget, a save the chair budget for this government, and even that it doesn't do very well. Broadly, there are two types of taxes, direct taxes, indirect taxes. Direct taxes are known as progressive taxes. Why are they progressive? So income tax, property tax, investment tax on capital gains, these are done in a way that the richer you are, the more tax you pay. So they're kind of fairer. Sir, please. Sir. Indirect taxes are regressive. Because everyone from the richest billionaire to the poorest laborer is paying the exact same tax. So GST, duties on petrol, duties on diesel are all indirect taxes. When we strive for a fair and equitable economy, we must have the balance of direct taxes and indirect taxes right. The US and the Europe broadly collect about 60% through direct taxes and 40% through indirect taxes. Some Scandinavian states with welfare models collect 70% through direct taxes, 30% from indirect taxes. In India, it is the exact opposite. 65% of tax collection comes from indirect taxes, where billionaires pay the same as the poorest laborers, and only 35% comes from direct taxes. Even within the direct tax bracket, for the first time in our country's history, salaried professionals and the middle class are sharing a greater tax burden than rich corporates. The middle class is contributing 55% of direct income taxes under this government, up from 38% under the UPA. The richest corporates in India today contribute only 45% of direct taxes. Not only is the middle class being taxed, but now with this budget, the savings of the middle class have also been taxed with removal of indexation and with a rise in the short-term capital gains. Investors who've made more than 11% return, we've done the calculation, that's about the threshold rate. If you have made more than 11% returns, so if you've made higher returns, then this new tax regime with the removal of indexation has happened is good for you. Now, people like our parents, pensioners, salaried middle class, risk-averse people who invested in gold, in property, in debt mutual funds, the removal of indexation has harmed them disproportionately. So the middle class has lost out. Debt mutual fund holders will end up paying more than 40% more tax because indexation is being changed from 20% to 12% for investments made before April 1st, 2023. So this is effectively penalizing those who've made low profits. You've anyway made lower profits. People think real estate has made enormous profits. If you look at RBI's housing index for the past 10 years, the average rise in property prices has been between 4.5% and 5%. So if the middle class is invested in property, that is below 11% return, so indexation is going to harm you. The current GST regime is irrational and iniquitous. There is 18% GST levied on life insurance and medical insurance products. The Honorable MOS Finance yesterday, on Monday, told this House that the government has collected 8,263 crores as GST on health insurance for the fiscal year 23-24 alone. This is blood money. Our Honorable Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee wrote a letter to the Finance Minister to the Centre, pointing out that this is a completely anti-people tax. What is life insurance? What is health insurance? It is people guaranteeing and spending money and protecting against life's uncertainties, right, against accident, against injury, against ill health, against death. What are you doing? You are imposing GST, same rate that a billionaire pays, the poorest middle class person has to pay. So people are deterred from taking out new policies. People are deterred from continuing existing insurance. This should be removed at the earliest. Now, let me now move on to what affects more than 70% of Indian citizens, social sector allocations. The general trend over the past decade, in every budget in the last 10 years, of which our Honorable Finance Minister has presented 7, has been in nominal terms, you have allocated more money to the social sector. But if you account for inflation and you look at real allocations, inflation adjusted, allocations have seen reductions of over 25% in the past 10 years. I'm going to look at real allocations, that is adjusted for inflation, for some major schemes in the past 10 years. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Minus 18%. Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, minus 9%. ICDS, which affects every child, it's a school scheme, minus 34%. Mission Anganwadi, minus 5%. PM Poshan, minus 45%. PMGSY, those of us who have rural areas, the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana scheme, minus 47% reduction in real terms. The National Social Assistance Program, minus 20%. The combined expenditure on 5 social schemes, the top 5 social schemes as a percentage of GST, of GDP, has declined from a peak of 0.93%, so almost 1% of GDP in 2009-10. Do you know where it is today? In 23-24, it is 0.36%. Oh my. It is only a third of what it was in 9-10. The MNREGA budget during COVID, when the center was telling all the states, please give employment to the laborers, they are going back. The MNREGA budget in 2021 was 0.6% of GDP. Do you know what it is today? 0.26%.
No,
specific budget figures for 24-25 are shameful. Specific figures, let's look at the specific figures. The allocation for Samarth, which is maternity entitlement and the creche scheme, has been reduced by 70 crores compared to budget estimates of last year. The budget for the National Social Assistance Program, for again, those of us with rural areas, you know how important this is. This is what gives social security pensions to the elderly, to single women, to disabled. This is unchanged from last year at 9,652 crores. 9,600 crores, same as last year, no adjustment for inflation. The central contribution to social security pensions has been unchanged since 2014. It was 200 rupees in 2014. It is still 200 rupees per person today. The price of the cutlets in the parliamentary canteen in the last 10 years have been adjusted for inflation with the government's approval. The price of the cutlets in the parliamentary canteen have more than doubled. But when it comes to giving social security for the poorest of the poor, it is still 200 rupees in the last 10 years, no change. This budget's allocation, there is no room for higher salaries for Anganwadi workers. Their salaries have been unchanged since 2018. No room for higher honorarium for midday meal cooks. You have to understand a lot of the women in villages depend on only Anganwadi sectors and midday meal sectors for any source of employment. There has been no higher allocation for supplementary nutrition given to children. The National Food Security Act, the NAFSA, mandates coverage of 67% of the population through PDS. The Prime Minister has very proudly proclaimed that this is a food surplus country. Fine. Then why have we not increased the population covered under rations Since 2011, you have not had a census. Since you have not had a census, you have not increased the number of people being covered under rations. Also, one very important question. Why is the central government blatantly defying the directions of the Supreme Court? We went to the Supreme Court on the migrant workers case. The Supreme Court gave an order, a direct order to the central government, that the central government is to give rations to 8 crore migrant workers of the unorganized sector who have been left out of the food security net. The last hearing was on 16 July 2024. Court again said that you have to please give money to the states which have issued additional cards, ration cards. But there's no room in the budget for this. There is no allocation. In this rush to protect its own chair, the government is making a very dangerous mistake, which is it's not giving enough to protect our borders. Military experts have repeatedly warned us that India's military capability has to be modernized because we are fighting on two fronts. One is against China, we need a dissuasive deterrent. Against Pakistan, we need an offensive deterrent. The budgetary allocation for defense in this budget is 6.22 lakh crores. This is a marginal decrease of 2,000 crores compared to revised budget estimates. We have reduced it by 2,000 crores. This year's allocation, the budget defense allocation, is 1.9% of GDP. This is the lowest since 1960. The lowest.
Shame.
Despite many economic constraints, past governments had always given close to 3% of GDP, which is the universal norm for defense. Over the last decade, ever since this government's been in power, it's been hovering around 2%. We have been unable as a government to compel China to restore status quo ante April 2020 on the line of actual control. We have been unable to deter Pakistan. In the last 2 months alone, over 50 security personnel and about 10 civilian pilgrims have been killed in Jammu. Capital expenditure on military equipment, 1.7 lakh crores. On paper, this shows that it's almost a 10% increase. What we haven't taken into consideration is this increase was largely due to Russia's inability to supply contracted weapons to us because of the Ukraine war. If we take into account inflation and we take into account the dollar, rising dollar rate, we're almost flat. The gap between projections made by the armed forces and between actual allocation is 17 to 23%. That's the gap. कुर्सी बचाने में आप मस्त है देश को भी देखिए वी नीड क्लोज टू 3% 2.5 to 3% ऑफ जीडीपी टू डिफेंस दिस इज समथिंग दैट द कंट्री नीड्स टू लुक एट द ऑनरेबल फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर स्टार्टेड ऑफ हर स्पीच बाय टॉकिंग अबाउट द फोकस ऑन अन्नदाता और फार्मर्स एंड हाउ मच दिस गवर्नमेंट हैज डन फॉर फार्मर्स द इकोनॉमिक सर्वे ऑफ 24 says 42.3% ऑफ इंडियंस डिपेंड ऑन एग्रीकल्चर दैट 600 मिलियन पीपल दैट 60 क्रोर पीपल If I looked at the economic survey 22nd July very carefully, what did the headline say? The headline says, agricultural sector has registered an annual average growth rate of 4.18% in the last 5 years. But then I needed to read and read and read. And in the fine print was written that last year was only 1.4%. So 4.18 over last 5 years is anyway, when you compare it to inflation, is nothing. But when you compare last year's growth of only 1.4%, what is it saying for 60 crore of our people who depend on farming? Productivity and resilience in agriculture was one of the first themes, priority number one, according to the finance minister's budget. She had made 9 priorities. This was priority one. But the provision for agriculture and allied sectors is only 1,52,000 crores. Whereas the provision for one bullet train from Ahmedabad to Mumbai is 1,08,000 crores. Please look at the comparisons, everybody. Priority two, finance minister said, is employment and skilling. This government has got the worst track record of creating jobs. India has more jobs in the informal sector, not in the formal sector. The budget is talking of an internship program with the top 500 companies. This is a joke. The top 500 companies employ 70 lakh people in total. That is 1% of the total workforce. Our workforce is about 57 crores. You are expecting companies which have a total work, which employ 70 lakh people, to give employment to 1 crore interns. Please let us know how this is going to happen. I'm really curious. The real problem is somewhere else. The real problem is that 10.3 crore youth have basically become so dejected, they have given up looking for jobs. The finance minister, she mentions skilling loans, she mentions education loans. Skilling loans are for 25,000 people, education loans are for 1 lakh people. The country has 140 crore people. Now, what are we doing? Priority 3, according to the finance minister, inclusive human resource development and social justice. In this section, the budget says, first on Bihar, we will support expressways. What you're not saying is that you will make expressways which will charge very high tolls. So you are recovering the money, you're not doing anyone a favor. You're charging back-breaking tolls. You might give another bridge which might collapse.
Yes.
You will set up another power plant, which like Jharkhand may also be outsourced to a favorite businessman.
Correct.
He can be given a nice juicy PPA and sell more imported coal. Secondly, on Andhra, there are no grants, but only loans, that too from multilateral agencies. So basically, dollar loans will be given to Andhra Pradesh, which future generations will have to pay back with interest.
Sure.
There was also another sweeping statement. Grants for backward regions of Rayalaseema, Prakasam and North Coastal Andhra, as stated in the Act, will be provided. I looked in the entire demand for grants with a tooth comb, with a microscope. And I looked at the expenditure budget. Nothing was provided anywhere. I don't see the intelligent people of Andhra being fooled by this. Priority 4, manufacturing and services. The finance minister has devoted an entire section on how MSMEs are a priority. I believe her. Yes, it should be a priority. But I'm very confused. Most medium and small enterprises are either proprietorships or partnerships. Madam, can you please explain why these proprietorships and partnerships are taxed at higher rates than companies? This makes no sense. Is the A-team the only businesses who are sending truckloads and tempo loads? MSMEs are not sending. Is that the problem? And also, the government needs to get rid of the bizarre 29A of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, because it is killing companies that are in trouble. It does not allow promoters to propose a resolution plan. As long as we have this code, promoters cannot propose a resolution plan. We need to get rid of this. Priority 5 in the finance minister's speech, urban development. The prime minister had said every citizen will get a house by 2022. We are now in 2024 and we are still making allocation for 3 crore more houses.
Yes.
Can you please tell us how many more houses we need and when it's going to be done? Let's get this over with.
2047.
Priority 6, energy security. The less I speak about this, the better it is. Energy security is security for best friends. It's created by allowing best friends to import low-grade quality coal, mark it up as high-grade quality coal, and sell it to state development corporations at the cost of the country's environment, at the cost of the health of our citizens.
Shame.
Priority 7, the finance minister said, was infrastructure. She announced in a true style of Shagun that she's gifting the nation 1,11,111 crores. 1,11,111. This is flat on last year. Sadly, most of this will go towards crony capitalists. You'll make roads that have potholes, you'll have airports that leak, you will have bridges that fall out, and the taxpayer will pay for this. The budget speaks of private sector participation. But remember one thing, they bid out 6 airports to one company for a fee to be paid by the government. Then they created a policy that allows the regulator to keep increasing the user development fee. So actually, it's the flying public of India that are paying for this. Priority 8. Innovation, research and development. Grand words, these are just grand words. The finance minister seems to have forgotten that most entrepreneurs register their product and software IPs in foreign countries like the US. Since IP registration system for patents is a complete failure in our country. Unless you fix patent registration, this is not going to happen. The last priority she talks about is next generation reforms. This is also another jumla. She says, I propose to earmark a significant part of a 50-year interest-free loan for competitive federalism. So this is double speak. We'll keep this money in our pocket. If Nitish ji and Chandrababu ji see through our jumla and they make a big fuss, we'll have some additional funds to keep them happy and to keep the government going. Finally, I have to mention one interesting fact, and I hope that the Treasury benches will have the patience to hear me out. Please. I wholly agree with the finance minister on one thing. The budgets for the CBI and the ED have been reduced this year, and I was wondering why. Is it because the voters didn't like the fact that you were using the CBI and the ED to go after the opposition and file fake affidavits? Or is it because you have outsourced the CBI and the ED completely to a businessman in Ahmedabad who's controlling the whole thing? Why have you reduced it? Number one. former Maharashtra Home Minister highlighted how BJP leaders and agencies have threatened him to filing a fake affidavit. In the case of Sandesh Kale in West Bengal, the women have confirmed on video that BJP leaders forced them to file fake statements. Similarly, I'm told in my matter, Mr. Adani on October 16, 2023, got my friend to his office in Ahmedabad and threatened him with dire consequences to file a fake affidavit. Actually, it was Mr. Adani's in-law, Mr. Cyril Shroff, who filed the fake affidavit and forced him to sign it. Even today, every mid-level official in Adani's office calls mid-level officials in the CBI and says, 161 statement change karaiye, aapka sir ko bulaiye, madam ke against mein statement dijiye. I'm telling the CBI, why are you, madam? Please take a 164 statement once and for all. Don't keep calling back people at Adani's behest to change 161 statements to implicate me. It's going to get you nowhere. Let us reduce the CBI and the ED budget to zero. Let us, Mr. Adani, pay the full 1500 crores. Let us outsource it completely to him. End of story. In short, this Kursi Bajao budget is a desperate attempt by the government to stick its head in the sand and act like that the mandate of 2024 never happened. But the coming days are going to prove the instability of this government and the inefficacy of its economic policy. We wait for that day. Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.